Hello, good morning, and welcome to Ireland Today. I'm on Virgin Media One.
Well, from former footballers to Bollywood stars, we have got a busy show coming up over the next 3 hours.
We really do. After 80s, the Republic of Ireland football legend, who features in a new film about the toxic nature of punditry and the sport itself, Tony Cascarino will be here to tell us all.
Can't wait to chat to him. And from one football star to another, Peter Crouch, happy to talk to him.
And
Abby Clancey. Looking forward to chatting to her. They're going to join us after 9 to chat about their new relationship podcast.
I love it. I really, really enjoy it. They're incredibly funny.
Characters, the two of them.
They are. And from Bollywood to Hollywood, Citadel star Priyanka Chopra Jonas will be telling us all about headlining her very first big American rom-com. We'll have that a little bit later on.
Wow. And now for a look at what else is coming up. Over to you, Al.
Well, Tommy, in the kitchen this morning, we're going to serve up some chicken satay with our chef Eva Pau. And in fashion, we've got the perfect looks for the summer season. Now, Derek is going to channel his inner Viking. He's in the centre of Dublin this morning. What have you got planned for us, Derek?
Yes, Al, you know me, I love a challenge. What else would I be doing on a... what is this? It's a Wednesday morning. Anyway, following a beautiful day in Clare yesterday, we have plenty of showers through the west and the northwest out there at the moment, and day three of all that thundery activity. But Dublinia, just over my shoulder, we're going to be taking you on that Viking medieval tour right across the morning, guys. And on a separate note, got it for Wild Youth. They did so well last night in the Eurovision, didn't they?
It was gutting, yeah. We'll be chatting about that and making the news.
He's making some comments over there. We will be chatting about that in just a little while. Also, if you want to play Derek Bingo later on to see he's going to be in a helmet, a cape, there'll be a sword, no doubt about all of that. But coming up, we're going to be talking about grocery prices and how it's affecting you. If you want to get in contact, it's 0896-111-111. But right now, let's go over to the Virgin Media News Hub. Here is Hannah Murphy.
Thanks, Mirren, and good morning. Well, representatives of the supermarket and retail sector are due to meet with the government today to discuss the increase in the cost of groceries in recent months. The government will urge retailers to do whatever is needed to lower prices. It's also expected to take the unusual step of not opposing a Sinn Féin motion in the Dáil on price gouging.
Shoppers have been seeing the cost of their groceries and other products increase for over a year now. Despite a slowing in the rate of growth of inflation, there's no significant sign yet that food and grocery prices are starting to fall. Grocery inflation is running at just over 16% year on year, according to recent figures from Kantar. A meeting of the retail forum has been convened for today. Members of government are set to meet with representatives of the major supermarkets and retail sector. Some of those in retail say the passing on of savings will take time. Some farmers have criticised moves by the supermarkets to cut the prices of butter and milk in recent weeks, saying their livelihoods are being squeezed too, and the government must balance the push for lower prices with their concerns. Marie Mulcahy, Virgin Media News.
A jury in the United States has found Donald Trump liable for sexually abusing writer E. Jean Carroll in a dressing room in 1996. Jurors in the civil trial did not uphold charges of rape, instead finding him responsible for a lesser degree of sexual assault. The former president of the United States has also been found liable for defaming Ms. Carroll after she made her allegations public. Mr. Trump was not in the courtroom as the verdict was read out. He's been ordered to pay $5 million in damages to E. Jean Carroll. The judgment adds to the legal woes of the former president, who's also contesting the 2024 race for the White House. Soon after the verdict, Donald Trump lashed out with a statement on his social media site, during which he also confirmed that he plans to appeal.
What else can you expect from a Trump-hating, Clinton-appointed judge who went out of his way to make sure that the result of this trial was as negative as it could possibly be, speaking to and in control of a jury from an anti-Trump area, which is probably the worst place in the United States for me to get a fair trial. We'll be appealing this decision. It's a disgrace.
A Fianna Fáil senator has said it's inflammatory to say that putting GAA games behind a paywall is a backdoor tax fee. Yesterday, RTE defended the GAA Go pay-to-watch service, with the broadcaster's head of sport insisting there'll be no change to the GAA matches that'll be shown behind a paywall this season. But Declan McBennett suggested the format might be looked at again at the end of this year's championship. The matter was brought up in the Dáil yesterday and is likely to flare up again when the All-Ireland football series gets underway in a fortnight.
there is a perspective in this argument, yeah. which is obviously enraging people, but there's good sides as well, that if I was an Antrim fan, I could watch the entirety of my match as opposed to just 30 seconds in the Sunday game on Sunday night. So I think calling it a backdoor tax fee is more inflammatory language, maybe to curry favour with the public, because the public aren't happy about this. But as a GAA fan, and I'm a diehard GAA fan, I know that the products that are being offered for GAA fans, there's a lot of GAA fans, and they're damn happy to be able to watch their matches as well and pay the €2.
In Beirut, protesters have smashed the windows of banks demanding their money back. Demonstrators used fireworks as tensions with riot police and the bank's own security escalated. Police were accused of using batons during the protest. Banks have restricted withdrawals since the country's economic crisis hit 3 years ago. And there was disappointment as Ireland failed to qualify for the final of the Eurovision Song Contest last night. Dublin band Wild Youth were flying the green flag during the first semi-final, which took place in Liverpool. The UK is hosting the competition on behalf of last year's winner Ukraine, which cannot host due to the ongoing war. There were 15 acts competing for 10 places. Ireland hasn't qualified for the final since 2018.
We compare 14 insurance quotes to get you the best deal. So choose chill and work smarter, not harder.
Thank you, Chair, and a very good morning. We're live here from Christchurch in the heart of Dublin City Centre this morning. We're off to explore our Viking and medieval history as we pay a visit to Dublinia, just over my shoulder here. So that's all to come later on this Wednesday morning. Now, let's take an opening look at weather together. We had a beautiful one in Clare yesterday, but a different story out there this morning. Plenty of rain now hitting the Banner County. In fact, eight counties, including Galway, Mayo, through parts of Cavan, Longford, into Offaly and County Leitrim. Some heavy rain crisscrossing those counties at the moment, so stay nice and dry. Elsewhere, it's a good day of cloud cover now with some limited bright breaks on the breakfast menu. Now, right across into this afternoon, we're looking at light to moderate westerly winds there in the driving seat, and very similar to yesterday. We're going to see some sunshine, but once again, plenty of thundery activity, and the bulk of that thunder will be lodged in across the northeast. A little bit cooler as well in terms of those temps at around 11 to 15 degrees. And across into this evening, then, again, plenty more thundery showers on the cards. Building through the northwest, then we have another system bringing with it rain. And from evening then into night, we're going to see that system track southeastwards across the country. So another bumpy ride as we work our way over the next couple of hours. So that's how we're shaping up here in a chilly Christchurch here in Dublin City Centre. We'll be back again live at 7:35.
Chill insurance work harder, so you can work smarter. We compare 14 quotes to get you the best deal.
Now, we're getting ready to make the breakfast, are we?
We
doing
are.
Toast today? No.
Love
After the break,
roll.
We're going to be discussing rising supermarket prices and what actions the government can take to curb them and whether they can do anything to curb them.
So, is today's supermarket summit with the government officials all for show, or will we see any actual price change? You have your let us know what you think. Get in touch now. Please do 0896 111 111. We would like to hear from you. I mean, you know, how is this hitting your shopping bills every week?
And does it just feel like we're the second worst in Europe for grocery inflation, but it feels like we're the worst for everything? You know, concerts, transport, when it comes to energy. Like, why is it allowed to be so expensive in Ireland? Please let us know what you make of it. And we'll see you back here in just a few minutes.
You're very welcome back. Now, a meeting of the Retail Forum is taking place today with major retailers, producers and distributors expected to discuss a reduction in grocery costs. And here to examine just how much our everyday products have increased in price is savvy saver Sarah Adekola. Good morning to you,
good
Sarah.
Morning.
How are you?
I'm good,
and
thank
we're
you.
Just looking at four basics here that everybody in every home buys every day or every week if they do their big supermarket shop. Now, we are talking about like what we had last year in May 2022 and what the average was there and what it is now. So let's go through the milk first. So it was on average 269 in 2021. So what is it now?
So right now, if you're to shop at Tesco's for your 2-litre full-fat milk, it's £2.49. And that's the Avonmore brand. For Aldi, that's coming in at £2.19 for their own brand. And for Dunnes, that's coming in at £2.19. So this is coming after a 40-cent reduction in the... A 10 cent reduction in the cost of milk.
Yeah, because there was a reduction in all dairy products last week, and it was big, like big announcements in the supermarkets. Oh, look, dairy's going down, but we can still see here
that it's still quite high.
It's still quite high, and especially like the £2.49 if you are buying the Avonmore.
That's like an over 40% increase from the CSO statistic in 2021.
Okay, now in May 2021, your average pound of butter was £2.98. Mm-hmm. So where are we now?
So the cost now for Dunnes stores, Avonmore, is £3.95. So that's coming in at an over 30% increase. For Aldi, Kerrygold is £4.29.
£4.29. So that's pretty hefty jump.
And then Tesco's own brand is £2.99.
So that £4.29 in the Kerrygold is still, even after the reduction from last week.
That's like an over 40% increase in comparison to this. CSO data from 2021.
Now, every household like buys a lot of bread every week, and in 2021 your average slice pan was £1.36. So we're seeing some reductions here in some of them.
Yeah, so you're seeing a reduction in the ones where it comes to the own label brand. So for Tesco, it's going to be 99 cents. And for Dunnes Stores, it's 1.49. And Aldi, Brennan's collection is coming in at 1.99.
So that's Brent, that one is higher. The only one that's dearer than it was in 2021.
Yeah.
So that's good value. So at least that is coming down. And that is a real staple in most homes. Now, tea bags. So 2021, it was average £2.79. How are we looking now?
So for today, we're looking at Tesco's own brand at £1.49. So you can see that's drastically cheaper than 2021. For Dunnes, Barry's is coming in at £3.80, which is a little bit more expensive. And then for
Aldi's, nearly a euro more expensive,
And then for Aldi's own brand, that's coming in at £1.25.
So we're looking at majority maybe going up in price, but there are still reductions to be had and some bargains to be found.
So the branded things like the Barry's are obviously going to naturally be more expensive, but if you go for the own label brands, so like Tesco brand, Super Value, Dunnes, you're going to get better savings there.
You will get savings there. Yeah. Thank you very much for that. Now for more details on the Supermarket Summit, which is happening today, over to Tommy and Warren.
Thank you very much, Alan. As you mentioned, the Retail Forum, a group comprised of government officials and industry representatives, is meeting today to discuss inflation and charges of price gouging.
Here to tell us about today's forum and if prices will indeed come down is Minister for Retail, Neale Richmond. Neale, thank you so much for joining us. I know that you've called this forum a little bit later on, the Supermarket Summit. We have asked people from the retail sector to join us here today and no one would. Do you expect anything to happen? Because Ireland is known as being one of the most expensive countries in the Eurozone and in the EU, and it seems like there is nothing ever done about it.
Well, some things are done, but I think fundamentally things will happen after today. We were due to meet, we meet the Retail Forum every quarter, we were due to meet at the end of June, and instead we've brought it forward for a singular topic meeting purely on grocery prices this afternoon at 2 o'clock. All the major retailers are coming in, their representative bodies, Retail Ireland, Retail Excellence Ireland, people from my department, from academia. And we're going to be going through where there's been quite clear evidence of price inflation in Ireland. It's at 16.9%. It's been felt in supermarkets across the country. It's been felt in households across the country. It's simply not acceptable. And where we have seen other European countries have obviously experienced the same issues, and we understand it. Inflation has gone up, prices have gone up in terms of fuel, in terms of fertiliser for the producer, but inflation is coming back down. It's peaked and coming back down. So whilst we accept that the prices had to go up when input costs were going up, now that input costs are coming down, we expect to see, and that will be the main message today, we expect to see prices coming down for the consumers at the checkout till too.
You mentioned there about the 16.8%. Like almost 17% in the first 12 weeks of this year is astronomical. And when you're seeing Alan talk about the prices in just over a year, I mean, it's quite shocking that this is genuine price gouging. You would have to think by some supermarkets out there taking advantage of people who are really struggling to put things onto their table at the moment. Why have the government decided now is the time to get tough on the supermarkets?
So this has been consistently raised in the Dáil for the last number of weeks by government and opposition backbench TDs. We see it coming into our constituency offices. People are really talking about how they're feeling this as a pinch. We've introduced a series of cost of living measures when it comes to rent, when it comes to electricity, but now is the key time where we expect to see grocery prices should have come down by now. We expect the usual six-month lag when it comes to inflation peaking and coming down, when energy costs coming down, to actually see that. But we haven't seen it. However,
because Labour have been banging this drum for a long time. And it seems it's taken a long time for the government to actually react to it.
Well, I think Jed Nash brought it up in the Dáil first to me about 3 or 4 weeks ago and responded to him at the time and spoke to him again last night in the debate. He asked for a number of measures. Jed Nash, their spokesperson, set up the retail forum when he held the position that I hold now previously. So fundamentally, we feel this is the first place to go. We look at the continental examples. France were a little bit ahead of this in terms of it impacted them earlier. They convened their equivalent of the retail forum, and the supermarkets undertook to their business minister that through from April to June that they'd work to bring down prices. Other countries have taken a far more draconian approach. Greece, Hungary, Croatia. Now, they had much, much higher grocery inflation than we did. Hungary had 50%, Croatia had 20%. The problem with the measures they took, and Jed mentioned these in the Dáil last night, price caps, there's massive unintended consequences of them. There does lead to supply issues. It's really, it's something we have the power to do, but no one should ever advocate doing it. Rather, what we want to achieve is a genuine, frank and honest conversation with the retailers today. We'll be producing a dossier of similar price rises that we've just gone through there today. We want to work through and say, look, farmers aren't getting paid anymore. There is obviously a gap here, either in the food companies or the retailers. We have seen where there's been huge profits in certain.
What happens if they say no?
Well, the powers that we have are quite clear, and I said they're quite draconian. We do have the power to cap prices under the consumer.
But you really don't want to, probably won't.
We don't want to. We shouldn't have to be honest. The legislation's been there for 16 years now in the Consumer Protection Act. It's never been used. It shouldn't have to be used.
Yeah.
The government shouldn't have to get involved in the market. The government really shouldn't have to be calling an emergency meeting of the retail forum to go through it. But we are, because it's so serious, and we're seeing it in households and supermarkets around the country.
Is this not a cultural problem? Because as you said, no one wants to see food caps, because next thing you see supermarkets going to the food cap and not bringing prices back down. But when you've got food, like general inflation is at 6%, food inflation is close to 13% now. But in Ireland, we're consistently expensive, and we're always told, but sure, we're an island nation, it takes so much to get here. It doesn't take that much to get here. Mm-hmm. And consistently in the Eurozone and EU, we are always up there as having one of the highest costs of living in comparison to other countries. But we've got these purchasing powers. But these, like we can even see with when it comes to like the energy bills, like the reductions aren't being passed on to Ireland. Why is this allowed to happen continually? It's not a new thing. We're always one of the most expensive countries.
Yeah, we're one of the most expensive, but it comes down to proportionate in terms of the salaries are much higher in Ireland compared to the EU average. The food inflation rate in Ireland is right in the middle in the EU. We're not the highest, as I mentioned, Hungary at 50%. We're certainly not the lowest. There are very serious costs, and we've seen over the last year, and we've accepted when supermarkets and producers said, in terms of energy prices, in terms of fertiliser costs, in terms of inflation, their costs have gone up. But the government have acted on that. We brought in the Business Energy Support Scheme. We brought in grants. We've worked with retailers to support them in the tough times, just like retailers worked with us when it was very tough in terms of the pandemic, ensuring that we could get people fed and people were able to get it.
Are you slightly worried that they are? Because as they said last week, you know, butter and dairy is going to come down. But that's hitting farmers in this country rather than hitting the big boys who control the groceries. Like we know there's massive multinational conglomerates that are making an awful lot of money. But yet they're going, oh, look, we can raise the prices. It's going to affect individual farmers here.
Well, that is a concern, and this is where we're going to be quite blunt. There should be no reason why farmers will see any reduction in the prices they're paid at the farm gate after this summer. We look at certain dairy companies that saw their profits go up by 41.7% last year, but those didn't see any savings for consumers and didn't see any extra major prices for farmers. There's something stuck here in the middle, and that's why we're going to be saying, if you're saying you can't bring down prices, well, let's see your profit margins. Let's see the bonuses that were paid to directors. Let's see where retailers and food companies need to step up to the plate, because the government is taking this meeting for a reason today. We're going to meet again, as I said, on the 21st of June. It'll be an agenda item then, and we expect to see in that seven-week period serious efforts and reductions made.
OK, interesting stuff. I mean, fair play to the government for doing this. It's taken its time, but we'd be really interested to see how the supermarkets react to it, of course. And we'd love to hear from you at home on this as well, 0896 111 111. How are these prices impacting you? And do you think it's a little bit too late that the government are finally taking these retailers to task on it. Neale Richmond, Minister for Retail, thank you for coming in to join and to talk to us this morning.
Thanks a million. Still to come, we'll be taking a look at the top stories making the morning papers.
Plus, we're going to meet the 10-year-old TV executive who has created a hit cartoon series. Our Ireland M is back very shortly.
We're going to have toast. We've got so much bread. Time now to take a look at this morning's paper, starting with the Irish Times. Its headline, Trump sexually abused journalist, jury finds. A jury in New York has found the former US president liable for sexually abusing and defaming a magazine columnist in the 1990s. Trump now owes writer E. Jean Carroll $5 million.
The Irish Daily Mail also leads with that same story. Their headline, is this the end of Trump's new bid to be president? Yesterday's ruling deals a potentially devastating blow to Trump's 2024 White House run.
And the Mirror goes with Trump, the sex attacker, the former US president has branded it the greatest witch hunt of all time.
In other news, lender forced to lower rate on Vulture Fund mortgage. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. A leading mortgage servicer acting on behalf of Vulture Funds has been forced by a court against its will to give a cheap long-term fixed rate to a borrowing couple.
The Examiner's front page, shops given 6 weeks to reduce prices. Minister of State Neale Richmond has called an emergency meeting of the Retail Forum this afternoon amid soaring food and grocery costs, which are putting extra strain on families.
The Herald goes with gang boss forced to plan Lawler murder. The PSNI is seeking to extradite Sligo gangland boss Barry Young in connection with the murder of rival criminal Robbie Lawler once he finishes his sentence for directing a drug gang.
The Star's front page, silence of the Clan. Kinahan target Patsy Hutch rolled his eyes and refused to comment when confronted that he plotted the Regency Hotel shooting despite being named by Ms. Justice Tara Burns as the possible organiser of the hit.
And finally, The Sun leads with two-for-one deal. RTE chiefs are hoping to land Cat Deeley as a host after hubby Patrick Keelty became favourite to replace Ryan Tuberty. A TV insider has said she has star power. It would be a massive win-win for them.
They suspended betting on it.
They could do with a win-win at the moment, but anyway, we'll come to that.
We'll come to that in a second. But they suspended betting on it on Patrick Keelty.
Should they suspended betting on Clare Byrne a couple of weeks ago as well?
Oh, did they?
Yeah.
All right, not up to date. Right, means nothing. And we were just talking to. And by the way, now for a closer look, Jack Horgan Jones from the Irish Times. You're here, and we were just talking about grocery prices, nappies.
Yes.
You're all over the nappies being crazy expensive.
Yes.
It's mad. €5 cheaper if you've got a
Tesco's club
Tesco
card.
Club card.
Yeah.
For nappies.
Yeah, I want to know who actually buys like the big brand name nappies and doesn't go own brand name. Like, who are these crazy people?
Like, it's got to say, well, it's the leakage, you see. If that saves me from a poo inferno, yeah, absolutely.
A poo inferno.
Poonami,
wow, okay.
Isn't that what it's called?
Poonami.
Poonami.
Absolutely, I'll do anything for that.
Anyway,
let's move on to the other story at the top of a lot of the papers this morning is Donald Trump, still with a thumbs up over here, but he's in a bit of trouble yesterday.
Yes, so this is the finding by a Manhattan jury that Donald Trump sexually abused, battered and defamed the magazine writer E. Jean Carroll in the 1990s. She had brought this case, a civil case, it must be said, alleging these things in New York court. And the jury found in her favour on almost all charges yesterday, accepting the central allegation that she made, which was that of rape. But notwithstanding that, it's an enormously damaging finding and potentially enormously financially damaging finding against Donald Trump, who has been told to pay €5 million between damages and costs to Ms. Carroll. Now, this is obviously a charge that he confronted from the first tee box of his golf club in Doombeg
last week.
Yeah, and I was there and saw this incredible stream of invective that he unleashed, you know, attacking her character and her motivation, and also the court system in New York and you know, basically slandering the judge, saying he was a Clinton appointee and all these kind of things. Now, of course,
this come into the case, the ruling? Over the
no,
last
it
days.
Didn't.
No.
And, okay. and like, I mean, the most interesting thing I think is that he was perfectly comfortable to make these kind
statements,
of slanderous allegations,
yeah.
and you know, undermine the case from thousands of miles away from a property that he owns on the far side of the Atlantic Ocean. But his lawyers put down no official defence in this case.
Yeah.
They called no witnesses for the defence, and despite suggestions last week that he may actually turn up in court in New York to defend himself, he did nothing of the sort.
Yeah.
He prefers to fight these things things, I think, in the realm of public opinion and, more importantly, in the realm of the opinion of his base, you know, these kind of fanatic fans in the eyes of whom he can do no wrong. And that's why I think you see these kind of very, very kind of loud engagements and these kind of these slanders, as opposed to engagement with the substance of the thing.
He did say in
the court of law,
when he was being deposed, when he was shown a picture of Eugene Carroll and they said, "Who is that?" He said, "That's my wife, Marla." Mm. So he thought that, you know, the oblongs look the same. But also, as you mentioned, motivation. A lot of people are wondering why this is happening now. New York introduced a moratorium essentially for old sexual abuse cases. So there's 1 year.
30 years ago, isn't it?
Yeah, but there was 1 year that New York said, if there's anything that happens to you historically, you can bring the case for this 1 year.
Yeah, so effectively, it put the statute of limitations on ice for a year. And so she took advantage of this. She wrote a book in 2019 detailing these claims for the first time. She took advantage of that that window to bring the court case, so, and has now successfully sued him in a civil case. There's no criminal upshot, but of course the question is whether there's going to be a political upshot for him. I'm dubious as to whether
The Daily Mail says, is this the end of Trump's new bid to be president? Probably anything but.
No,
I mean, people who are
money.
Trump supporters will help him. Anyway, let's move on to another story that's in the Herald and a load of the papers as well this morning. It's following on from this GAA Go and RTE. I was surprised, I actually didn't know that RTE were a 50% shareholder in GAA Go. And then, of course, Virgin came out swinging yesterday and said that, I mean, it's unfair. Like, you think about 50% ownership, like, where's the competition standards in this?
Yes. Yeah. So this has descended into quite a nasty and interesting little scrap between, on the one hand, I suppose, fans, and then on the other, the GAA and RTE, and then somewhere in the middle, the government, who have waded into this as well. The central charge here is that the GAA Go platform is playing host to too many important games, particularly in the Munster Hurling Championship this year, with a lot of high-profile games going behind that paywall. And the suggestion is that, you know, that consumers and GAA fans are kind of being strong-armed into paying the subscription fee, whereas a lot of these high-profile matches should, in fact, be on free-to-air. And look, the GAA Championship is so kind of culturally totemic in Ireland.
Yeah.
We know that anything to do with commercialising that, you have to tread incredibly carefully. And this is why this is kind of blowing up. And now this question's being asked over, as you say, Tommy, the structure of GAA Go itself, you know, the shareholding structure, obviously, divided between the GAA and RTE, and the kind of process whereby that came into existence, and whether or not there was sufficient transparency attached to it. Virgin Media last night issuing this statement kind of saying, look, you know, we were never actually given the chance to bid on this when Sky withdrew from screening games a couple of years ago. There was some seemingly fairly aggressive counter-briefing from, I presume, RTE last night, with sources suggesting that there were conversations between Virgin and the GAA at the time. So look, I'm not sure exactly where this goes, but I think it does have the potential to kind of blow back for RTE and for the GAA, particularly
when
you see
international pressure from international sports. This is our own sport,
and it's something that we hold very, very dearly. And you know, it's something that is obviously invested in every parish and every county up and down the country. And if people feel that there's an unnecessary or unfair commercial block being put between them and their GAA, people tend to react quite nastily to that. And you do see the Indo has a story today about a $1.1 million payout in dividends last year from the GAA Go company to RTE and the GAA. So I think there will be increased scrutiny on this, and it looks like we're heading for a Rathdis committee hearings. So, you know, it's an interesting early summer, late spring story.
It's a national broadcast, so they should be doing their best to do that and not be trying to monetize it. And when you see the GAA involved in this as well, very interesting.
We clearly do work for Virgin Media. You're watching that, and they have weighed into this.
Yeah, but they have offered that they would like to show it. They'd love to show GAA, I'm sure, on this channel as well. 0896 111 111. What have you made of that as well? Finally, let's touch on just Eurovision quickly. Wild Youth, you know, didn't make it through the semis.
Yeah.
Like, what is it? Why do we bother anymore?
I don't know. It's such a bubble that every year we're kind of told, like, you know, this is the year, and we're really hotly tipped, we could win it, and then we seem to fall short. So I'm not sure what to believe. But it did seem that, you know, there was a genuine confidence behind the Irish entry this year, and there is a genuine
disappointment. Well, especially last night, they were actually quite good. I ended up getting really into it for the first time. We shouldn't be discussing this over here without thrown over there to our official Eurovision lord and master, Alan Hughes, you said that they wouldn't get through, but I thought they showed they were good.
Like, should have got top 10, surely.
But you see, Tommy, look, I personally thought the band are great. I just didn't think they showed up last night.
Oh, you didn't think that they... Oh, right, okay.
I thought the staging was very bad. I thought Conor didn't sing into the camera. He played to the arena, which was brilliant, and he got them all clapping and chanting. They're not the ones who are voting.
That's interesting.
They're not the ones
who are voting. It's a man for experience, you see. Play to the cameras. Those people are voting, of course.
And can I tell you, the Eurovision betting, the official Eurovision betting website, got it spot on. They got every single top 10 last night. Where did Ireland come?
But last. Croatia, though.
We were last in the semi-final. Now, we won't know till Saturday when they release the official figures after the contest whether we did come last. But if it was spot on last night that the Eurovision official betting site got the top 10 and Ireland were 15th.
Okay, that's that's not great, but we're great in sport. Come here to me, but very quickly, they did a great job last night. Hannah Waddingham.
She's amazing.
She was brilliant, right?
She's amazing. She's going to be amazing with Graham Norton on Saturday.
Yes.
She's going to be amazing with Graham Norton on Saturday.
Very,
the BBC are doing a brilliant job.
We would love to hear from you on it. 0896-111-111.
Yeah, don't kill me.
Do you agree with that, Alan? Here we go. You can start coming from.
Jack Horgan Jones from the Irish Times. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Jack.
Tuned in as well. Alan, what else is coming up after the break?
Well, after the break, she's the creator of Ireland's latest hit cartoon series, and she's only 10 years old. Find out more after the break.
You're very welcome back. Now, what started off as a bit of a nightmare turned into a dream come true for one 10-year-old little girl who has become Ireland's youngest animation executive.
Yes, before we talk to Penny Lynch and her mum, Subi, about how it all happened, here's a look at her creation, Funny Little Monsters.
Monstrous fun awaits in Funny Little Monsters.
Funny little monsters. Funny little monsters. They could be tall or small.
As kids bring their funny little monsters to life in a joyful celebration of imagination. You never know what will turn up in Funny Little Monsters.
Funny Little Monsters.
Along
Penny and Subi, great to have you with us.
Thank you.
How are you?
Good.
Congratulations. That looks like my daughter and son are going to love this show. tell me, did the idea come from just a bad dream?
Yep.
What happened?
So, one day while I was at my holiday house in Wexford, I had a bad dream and I told my dad all about it. And he said to describe the monster that was in it. And I described it. I think I remember what it looked like. It had a beak, long tentacles, teeth.
Oh, that does sound scary.
I'm pretty sure three eyes. I can't remember exactly.
So what did he do?
So he said that... in the end, he said that I dropped my hat early in the dream. The reason it was chasing me was to try to return it. So it made it into a really funny little dream. And he thought that it was a good idea that, like, kids describing their monsters and then, like, turning what can be scary to, like, something completely and utterly ridiculous.
So he went and drew it all out for you and then kind of created a little story. So the two of you, this is great fun between dad and daughter.
Yeah.
And Subi, of course, you're your husband and yourself, you're in a production company, so you were able to put the creations together.
Yeah.
So how did then, what evolved after that, after the initial story?
Yeah, well, it's a really long process, isn't it, Penn? But Penn was involved in it along the whole way, weren't you? So we got, so once it kind of went into, like, became an idea from you guys, then, we asked children from all around Ireland to send in their drawings.
Of what they consider their monsters.
Their funny little monsters. And so we got loads and loads of submissions, didn't we?
We sent an email to every primary school in Ireland. Yeah. So, that's a whole lot of children.
Loads of children.
That must have been great fun then when all those coming in and you see what all the other children around Ireland, what their monsters looked like.
The creativity was amazing, wasn't it? The ideas were amazing.
Did you get to pick which monsters made it in then now that you're a TV executive?
Well, me and my dad and the Elk Studios and all the people who work with it, like I think 5 people from Elk Studios and me and my dad chose the 26.
Wow.
And like it all went between us all and once we like... When we all liked one monster, we were like, yep, that's it. That's it.
Did yours make it in?
I'm here, Tommy.
All right, who have you got?
Alan, the galactic salmon.
Do you want to tell Alan what the galactic salmon does?
Tell me what I do in your cartoon series.
It poops galaxies and burps black holes.
Sounds about right.
Very slippery and very smelly. Yeah, the salmon, that is right. So which one is your one? Can you find it for me?
Kind of closer to the end, isn't it?
Yeah.
And Subi, like, it must be amazing, like, the response that you get to send something like this out to all primary schools and for them then to see their creations come to life.
It's so lovely. And all the children then, they came to talk, like, to do the script, to do the voiceover. So we got to meet all the children and, yeah, just every kid now that is involved, like, they have their episode. They're all excited. All their friends and family members are, like, super excited whenever their episode is on. And
how many episodes are there?
There's 26 in total.
26?
And 28 children involved.
Because two of them have two children working on them.
Okay.
So there's the multicolored snail dog with two boys who were best friends who made
Catherine
it.
And Michael, yeah.
Yeah, and the last one has a boy and his sister.
Killian and Grace, brother and sister.
So go on, let's have a look at your monster. Who have you picked? Oh, the rooftop rumble. Oh my goodness, he looks scary, doesn't he? So how are you finding working behind the camera? Because a lot of people recognise you from the Super Value ad last Christmas as well. That must have been an exciting one to be a part of.
It was very exciting, very fun. Though it was quite tiring because, like, the earliest night that we stayed on to, I'm pretty sure it was 10:30 p.m. That was the earliest night that we
stayed. What? And how many nights did you work on it?
3 days.
3 days.
And three nights.
And did you have a nice name for the beautiful little reindeer that you're...
So it was a real reindeer and his name was Dermot. And his favourite food is digestive biscuits and he loved being petted.
And Penny, tell me, when you saw all the creations come to life after your dream and everything, the first time you saw it, what did you think when you saw it on TV?
I thought it was complete. I felt completely amazing. Because, like, it's not hardly any people get, like, there's hardly any people my age that get to do this.
Exactly.
And also that hardly any people get to, like have such friendship with their dads and bond over
You're
stuff.
Absolutely.
And your mom. Don't forget to be here.
Well, listen, when we see...
Would you like to give the guys their badges?
Do we have a badge?
Thank you so much.
Well, listen, world domination is going to take over. We're going to see this all over the world.
So. Yes, Funny Little
Penny
Monsters.
Penny and Subi Lynch, thank you so much, of course. If people want to watch Funny Little Monsters, it is on RTE Junior. Thank you so much for talking to us.
Thank you very much.
Alan, Armoran, what's coming up next?
We have you, Armoran.
Thank you. Still to come this morning, Tony Cascarino chats about making his film debut. That's all coming up after 8. Talk to you shortly. Hello, welcome back to Wednesday's Ireland AM. Do you know what? It's great to have you with us.
It sure is. Coming up from the toxic side of football fans to the responsibility of being a pundit. Tony Cascarino, I can't wait for this. Yeah. He's going to join us in the studio to chat about his new short film.
He's wearing these amazing glasses, everyone. They are very cool. Alan's going to want a pair immediately.
Right.
Also coming up just after 9, they're taking the podcast world by storm with their new parenting and relationship podcast. This could be You could do this. After 9, we're going to be talking to Peter Crouch and Abby Clancey. That could be you.
How do they stay in a relationship when working together?
Yeah.
And from a globe-hopping spy thriller to a Celine Dion rom-com, Citadel star Priyanka Chopra Jonas will be here to tell us about her Hollywood takeover.
Alan is over in the kitchen this morning with Hello. Hi.
Good morning, Chopra. Eva Pau is here and she's serving us. What are you serving us for this morning?
Satay chicken.
Is it easy to do now everyone watching in this morning? I'd never try a satay chicken at home.
I've got two special ingredients. One is this Jimmy satay sauce, which is amazing. So that's a special ingredient that we're going to use in it to make it really easy.
Okay, looking forward to that. Like a nice chicken with a satay. And now Derek is learning about Dublin's connection to the Vikings and I can imagine he's in full regalia. Yes, he is. There we go. There we go.
Ta-da! I've had a bit of a morning makeover. What do you think, guys? Do you like it? Not too bad, eh? Not too bad. Anyway, we're going to be heading back in time this morning. We've landed in here to Dublinia. We're going to be taking you on a Viking and medieval tour right across the morning. This place is absolutely fantastic. And look where, look, we're in. We even found you a real-life Viking. What do you think? We'll be sending back to studio to you. All the way from Norway.
I'm in.
He's
looking hot, to be fair. Those eyes. Hello. And I know you're growing the beard in.
Yeah. That was not quite the same. Take me a while, it will. Okay, Derek, we'll catch up with you later this hour. I'm looking forward to that.
We compare 14 insurance quotes to get you the best deal. So choose chill and work smarter, not harder.
Yes, thank you very much, Ger. We're live here in Dublinia, Christchurch in the heart of Dublin City Centre this morning. This is a Viking Longboat right behind me here, and we're going to be taking you on a Viking tour in around 8:45 this morning, so do not budge an inch. And we've got the full costume on as well, so never say we don't make an effort. Anyway, we're getting past 8 o'clock here together now. Let's take a look at how it's shaping up across the country. And rain gear at the ready through parts of southern Mayo and to go with Clare. Right up now through parts of East Donegal, Tyrone, parts of Meath, West Meath and Longford not escaping either. And elsewhere underneath that cloud cover, that threat of rain lingering now over the next couple of hours in those moderate to locally fresh westerly winds. Now, right across into this afternoon, very similar to yesterday, that ongoing threat of thunderstorm activity mainly focused through the northeast down there today. So once again, keep an eye on your pets. About 12 to 15 degrees in terms of those temps, so a little bit cooler as well out there this Wednesday. Across then into this evening, again more showers lingering, and by late evening into early night then we're going to see a system develop through the northwest, bringing with it rain that's going to track southeastwards across the country. So another bit of a rocky ride, a couple of rumbles of thunder as well to take us through into tomorrow morning, with that westerly airflow in the driving seat as we edge our way into tomorrow. So that's how we're shaping up for now. We'll be back again live in and around 8:35.
Chill Insurance work harder so you can work smarter. We compare 14 quotes to get you the best deal.
Now it's the time to take a look at this morning's paper, starting with the Irish Times. Its headline, Trump sexually abused journalist jury finds. A jury in New York has found the former US president liable for sexually abusing and defaming a magazine columnist. In the 1990s, he now owes writer E. Jean Carroll $5 million.
Both the Irish Daily Mail and the Mirror go with that same story. And in other news, lender forced to lower rate on Vulture Fund mortgage. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. A leading mortgage servicer acting on behalf of the Vulture Funds has been forced by a court against his will to give a cheap long-term fixed rate to a borrowing couple.
The Examiner's front page, shops given 6 weeks to reduce prices. Minister of State Neale Richmond, who was with us just earlier on, has called an emergency meeting of the retail forum this afternoon amid soaring food and grocery costs, which are putting extra strain on families.
The Herald goes with gang boss forced to plan Lawler murder. The BSNI is seeking to extradite Sligo gangland boss Barry Young in connection with the murder of rival criminal Robbie Lawler once he finishes his sentence for directing a drug gang.
The Star's front page, silence of the clan. Kinahan target Patsy Hutch rolled his eyes and refused to comment when confronted that he plotted the Regency Hotel shooting despite being named by Ms. Justice Tara Burns as the possible organiser of the hit.
And finally, the Sun leads with a two-for-one deal. RTE chiefs are hoping to land Cat Deeley as a host after hubby Patrick Keelty became the favourite to replace Ryan Tuberty. A TV insider has said she is star power and it would be a massive win-win for them. There you have it.
Now,
love it. We were talking about supermarket prices all morning. Obviously, Neale Richmond was in. They're going to be taking a lot of the retailers.
The supermarket forum.
Supermarket forum. Summit.
A summit. Yeah, it's not even a forum. Summit. It's a summit that's happening today.
So what about Gay? It's rip-off Ireland.
The deodorant again, because when we spoke about this last week, we got so many emails and texts from you talking about the price of deodorant. And Gail, yeah, it's rip-off Ireland at its best. A bottle of Dove deodorant. €9. I can't believe this. It was last year, it was 2 for 5 on a special, and the bottle's gotten smaller. There's lots of people making lots of money somewhere, says Gail. Joan, I was paying €2 for 3 litres own brand milk. That went to €3.20. So last year I paid €62 more for the year.
And if that's just for milk, can you imagine that if you add all that up to the other groceries?
Yeah, a message in here, and this is from a checkout worker. I work in a checkout in one of the major shops, and there is a serious change in shopping. For me, the saddest part is our older customers waiting for the reduced products and buying just exactly what they need, no more. So you're waiting for the yellow stickers to go on and then having to go shop later in the evening when they're there.
Sad.
That, do you know what? That kind of gets you right there, doesn't it?
Like, it's a social thing. You talk about loneliness. A lot of elderly people who are on their own go to the supermarket and you see them chatting to the checkout people
as well.
Absolutely. And talk about Eurovision as well. Obviously, Ireland crashed out. Alan said that they were last, according to the bookies, was it?
According to the bookies last night, who got all the top 10 who qualified spot on, and Ireland and the betting last night, the official Eurovision site, we came last.
And you felt that they played to the
they did a good job, but I thought they played to the auditorium who didn't vote. You need that connection with the camera and the viewers at home.
Well, somebody said Ireland were fantastic last night. It was a great night to be Irish. Who cares about the results?
And there Anthony thinks Alan has lost the plot. We were robbed last night. I lose the plot on a number of occasions.
And Stephen, I've seen better production at Alan's Panto than Eurovision last night. Get Sammy Sausages and Marty Morrissey to represent Ireland. Oh, yes, we will.
They won't. I thought when you see people...
Can you play to the camera, please?
Oh, sorry, when you see countries like Israel and Finland and Sweden last night, the production values were way up.
But your man from Finland can't sing.
Look at his production.
It's not about singing.
It's not about
singing.
And it's
like, it's the Eurovision, lads. Cha, 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 cha.
Play to the camera.
Sammy Sausages, that's what we want. Anyway, coming up after the break, I'm excited about this. The one, the only, Tony Cascarino is going to be in studio to talk about the toxic side of football.
And his excellent glasses.
Absolutely.
They're so good.
Stay with us. Well, he is a football legend who will forever be held in high esteem by Irish football fans.
Appearing as part of Virgin Media's Sharp Shorts films, Tony Cascarino opens up about life on and off the pitch. And before we speak to Tony himself, there he is. Just take those glasses in, everybody. Just hold that in your mind.
Amazing.
Here he is recalling the abuse he once received from a Celtic fan.
Probably the worst incident would have been when I was in Scotland and I was walking with my then wife, Sarah, in Glasgow city centre, and a guy approached me, and I could tell he was angry. He was pretty feisty, and he just started swearing at me and told me how crap I was and blah blah blah. And I stood there and looked at him, and I just said, "Look, mate, I know you're a Rangers fan, but back off a bit, will ya?" And he went, "I'm not an FM Rangers fan. I'm a Celtic fan."
Good morning, Tony Cascarino.
Good morning.
How are you?
Yeah.
You deal in this film about a lot of the toxic side of football in various ways. But we think of it these days and all the abuse that's sent on social media, and we see kind of the violence, and it's always been happening.
Oh, without a doubt, yes. I mean, it's always been there. It's just changed direction because social media has played such a big part.
Yeah.
That we'd wake up after a game the next day. Tommy would know. We'd all see the ratings and we'd all look at... you know, what we got, but that was a day later. And then maybe something in the week would be said, play a modern-day player now, gets their phone straight after their game, puts it on, and they're on social media, literally seconds.
Yeah.
So they're finding out reaction of fans, and most of them, if your team has lost, is angry, and then they go for certain players. So I've spoke to managers about this, and they're, you know, trying to tell players not to use their phone, not only before the game, but even after the game.
Like, we've seen racist abuse, we've seen all different types of abuse that supporters almost seem that they can get away with, whether it be on social media or certainly in the supporters, like, or when they're pitch side. Like, did you want to do this documentary to highlight this? Do you think that it's something that can change in football and in sport? Or what was the reason that you thought it was important to get this message out?
Well, it was a number of reasons, really. I did a book in 2000 with Paul Kimmage called Full Time, and it was a big success. And
an amazing book.
Yeah, and I really enjoyed doing it. And when I spoke to Paul originally, we chatted and I said, look, I don't want it to be just like an ordinary
book. Just, you know, I want it to be something where people pick it up and have a different view of someone who played in the game for nearly 20 years. I've been involved in football 41 years. Mm. So I had loads of different stuff in my head about what I wanted to do. And then I met Anna from Tri Moon Productions. We chatted and Anna had read my book. She really loved it. And then where can we take this further? Because football is changing and it's changing rapidly. And there is, I mean, look, supporters have this embedded in them where they just believe their club. You know, if we look at sports washing, you know, some clubs are doing things that politically, we was always told, don't get involved politically. Yeah. Now you nearly have to get involved with if you're a footballer or a sports person because it's so political.
Well, do you think they are? I think players aren't. I think they're trying to stay out of it.
Well, they're trying to. They're being advised to.
Yeah.
But they're going to be forced to.
Eventually.
Because, you know, when Ronaldo goes to Saudi Arabia and then Lionel Messi might go there, or, you know, and then it was China
a few
years.
For them, yeah.
Absolutely. So they end up getting... And at the moment, we have managers avoiding questions as well. Eddie Howe's answered nothing in regards to Newcastle because they're his bosses.
Yeah. But then you've got someone like Jurgen Klopp, who's quite politically invested in it. He brings it up quite a lot, going, well, you know why this is happening, like the money that is involved with all of these things. In that regard, I remember Graham Nassau, when he was with Chelsea, the slagging he used to get when he'd be seen carrying a newspaper, like The Guardian. It went on for ages.
Yeah.
So do you think you can isolate... What do you think it was all for show? But do you think you can isolate yourself from that because sports washing is now such a huge topic of conversation? And is it something that, yes, we're talking about, but has always been there?
Well, it's always been there in many different ways. Look, in many different guises because, you know, many football clubs did things wrong years ago. So they weren't excluded from where we are now. As the journey's gone, it's just gone different directions. You know, you've got countries, states owning football clubs, you know, which is in itself, well, there are going to be questions of what is their interest in taking a football club. Mm-hmm. And it can be political, it can be for the society, what they're creating in their home countries, that they want to be inclusive. So it's a really difficult one. And for me, on the outside, I've got more interested politically about football. I've always wanted to be, look, I watch football, I'm the pundit, and I want to talk about what I see on the pitch. I don't want to get involved in what's happening outside of football, away from the game, you know.
But that's changed, has it?
Yeah, and now I feel like, well, maybe I need to know more about what is happening within sport.
Because sports washing, like, it's nothing new.
And no,
football,
it's nothing new, you're right.
Has, you know, with the Qatar World Cup, there was a huge highlight, you know, focused on football from that. But if you think of Formula One, you think of LIV Golf, you think of even going back to the Munich Olympics. Like, sports washing has been a part of the sport going back for decades.
Yeah, and look how golfers are trying to, you know, to avoid every question regards LIV Golf.
But yeah. Where do you go? Like, what are, like, money makes the world go
just
around.
Just be honest.
Do you think so?
I think sportsmen need to be honest about... Look, you know, just if you want to go on the LIV Tour, and it's basically, it's only about one thing. It's about money. Most
but
of them would tell
their
you...
employers. So they won't be their employers for long if they're honest.
Well,
is that not true?
Why not? We all know. I agree with you. I'm like, just be honest. Like, just say, yeah, for money. I went there for money.
There are some golfers who have done that, but there's a lot that just refuse to answer any questions. Sport has been brought into the arena politically because, look, football and finance is just ridiculous. You know, clubs have earned $600 million a season.
Yeah.
You know, Manchester United. So they're being clubs being bought for $3 billion, $4 billion, and what's Man United going to go for $5 billion?
Yeah.
So there's a lot of vested interest in that.
And when you've got one of the biggest pundits in the world, Gary Lineker, continually getting involved in the political debate, it kind of sets
well, he
its tone.
Picks and chooses.
He yeah. Okay. Right. You think he picks and chooses what he likes?
Well, he can. Yeah. There's a lot of hypocrisy, I think, sometimes with Lineker.
Why?
Why? Because, well, he'll be very critical and then go and do the work in Qatar.
OK.
You know, OK, if you turn around and go, yeah, there's lots of things I don't like, and then you can say, I'm going to work there for money. Mm-hmm. But it feels like he's got both sides of the argument sometimes, I think, Lineker.
Well, absolutely. And Gary Neville got similar criticism as well.
I mean, I went to Qatar.
Yeah, right.
I went to Qatar, but I went there for the football and to watch it and to speak about it, but I'd never spoken, said anything about politically. But I also wanted to go there to see what is happening. They might have put on a show, which they did, and it was a great show, and they might have fed us something very different from what is a day-to-day basis, what happens in Qatar. Yeah.
But you also got paid to go there. It was,
yeah,
all,
I went there,
another
I got
reason,
paid, but I also I wanted to see what Qatar was about.
Listen, you're forever in Irish hearts, going back to the likes of Italia 90, being a part of that Jack Charlton era. Yeah, it was a special time. You know, we craved those days for the Irish soccer team to be back at that level again. You know, what was it like, the excitement for somebody who I suppose was living in England, but to come over to Ireland to be a part of that must have been amazing.
Yeah, I can only associate it, and I wasn't in a pop band, but it was amazing to be the euphoria, the happiness, the lads who just loved every second. If you look at the squads, I mean, if you ever look back and I, you know, check all the players that used to come and go, very few pulled out with injury. Everyone would come over even injured. We had a manager that was really easygoing. Jack was just unbelievable. He didn't like being around us. He'd tell us, well, I'm not hanging around you lot. I'm just going to train you, get ready for a game, and then you can go home. And that was it with Jack.
So that's what brought out the best. Almost that, like, laid off, kind of let
laid
them do
back,
their thing.
Laid back. Well,
he had a party lifestyle, didn't he?
We certainly, I mean, look, the squad would tell you that. We came in, we would all come in and we'd play on the Saturday. We'd come in on a Sunday. We'd go to Malahide Sunday afternoon and we'd be told we have to get back in by 10 o'clock and most of us didn't get in till 2. And then we would train Monday morning. Well, we wouldn't train Monday morning because training would be put back to Monday afternoon because the lads were still laying in. Jack allowed all this behaviour, yeah. But there was a bond that was so special, and it wasn't just with the players, it was everybody involved, from the fans, media. It was,
and when you build a bond like that, you leave nothing left on the pitch. And that was what everybody just bought into the Irish way of playing, because you might have bonded off the pitch, but on the pitch you gave it absolutely everything, which is what's important.
Well, Jack once said to us, if you like a drink, you've got to be fit to drink, meaning that you've got to run around when you play for me. So I'll let you have a little bit of, a little bit of easier lifestyle with us. And look, international football, you turn up fit.
Yeah.
You know, you've played for your club side, so you turn up fit. And Jack wanted everything that low-key.
We're just seeing some clips of Finding Jack, the documentary on him as well. But
it was
a special man.
So brilliant.
He was, and I enjoyed every moment. Look, he made us laugh, he made us cry, he upset for certain players at times because he was very sensitive, Jack. And a lot of people... So I was asked years ago about, give me 5 words of how you describe Jack, and I used the word sensitive. And they went, really, Jack? He's ruthless. And well, he's not, he's very sensitive. He doesn't like dropping players. What he does, his only way of dealing with it, is to go hardball with you. He told me when I got left out in 1990, I'm in the foyer in Sicily, and he walked across finally and went, you're out. And I went, sorry, Jack? He went, I'm not playing you. You're rubbish against the Egyptians. You're not playing. And walked off, just left me. But years later, I realised that was the only way he could handle it.
He couldn't deal with this.
He didn't like confrontation.
Yeah. It's
a pleasure that we could talk to you all morning.
We really could. And you're featured in the new sports documentary, Cascarino Voices. This is part of the Sharp Shorts, which is 6 short films on Virgin Media Television in partnership with Screen Ireland, where you talk about so many things, including your... I think we didn't even get a chance but to talk about the fact that you're not actually Irish. Listen, Tony Cascarino, it's a pleasure. He is, of course he is.
Of course he is.
It's a pleasure talking
Thank you.
We compare 14 insurance quotes to get you the best deal. So choose chill and work smarter, not harder.
Yes, Ger, we're live here in Dublin. We're going to be taking you back in time with a Viking tour here in the heart of Christchurch in Dublin City Centre at 8:45. So that's all to come in the next 10 minutes or so. Quick look at weather, and it's a very wet start through parts of the west and across central and northern regions out there this morning. So keep the rain gear handy. Stay nice and dry now over the next couple of hours in those light to locally moderate westerly winds. Now across this afternoon, we're going to see bright breaks, once again quite limited in nature. And day 3 of thunderstorm activity, the bulk of it mainly confined through the northeast around 11 to 15 in terms of those temps. And into this evening then, more thundery outbursts across the country by late evening into night. Then we're going to see another system through the northwest, more rain on the way sinking southeastwards as we edge our way into your Thursday morning. So a bit of a rocky ride over the next 12 to 24 hours. Anyway, that's how we're shaping up for now. Viking tour coming your way, 8:45.
Chill Insurance work harder so you can work smarter. We compare 14 quotes to get you the best deal.
Jared, thanks for staying with us. Tommy, do you know what?
What?
It's a beautiful day for what?
Chicken satay, which we've just heard. And Eva Pau is in the kitchen with us this morning. And Alan's told you, I'm not mad about it. But anyway, Eva...
we'll change his opinion.
I do like it. My husband loves chicken satay. He loves it.
And I do too, and I can't wait for this. Looks gorgeous.
Well, I have here some kind of marinated chicken. So you first marinate your chicken with a bit of Shaoxing wine, a bit of soy, some white pepper.
A bit of what?
Shaoxing wine.
Shaoxing wine.
So Chinese rice wine.
Okay.
And some soy sauce and some white pepper.
Could I put any rice wine in there? Or does it need, is that a specific flavour to that?
It
one?
Is. Like, okay. If you want the dish to be authentic, use the
Yes.
Shaoxing wine it is.
How long do you marry? Can you leave it in overnight or would you?
You can. Like, I've left it in overnight just to have more flavour.
Yeah.
But you can, if you don't have time, the first thing you would do is marinate the chicken and then you can chop all your vegetables.
Start on the rest of it, yeah.
Lovely.
So into the pan, I'm just going to add some oil and then some onion. So you can kind of choose whatever vegetables you have in your, like, in your kitchen.
Mm. Yeah.
So I have a mixture, I quite like the onion, and then I have a mixture of red and green pepper. So you just kind of put, because these will take a bit longer to stir fry, so I'm just kind of adding these in at the start.
And they're quite chunky, you don't chop them like, you know, really thinly, the onion.
You can. Well, they'll probably cook quicker if you kind of, but I
now,
quite like
am I doing it wrong? Because if I was doing this and I had my wok, I'd have it up really high, and so the minute you throw that in, it'd be all sizzling.
That should happen. So I'm just turning up the heat now.
Okay, sorry.
So yeah, it should be sizzling. It should be, you know. So one of the nice ingredients I'm going to show you today is this lovely kind of Malaysian babas curry powder.
Okay.
It's like a Malaysian curry powder. It's like babas meat curry, okay? Although it's not just for meat.
Okay.
I know it's labelled meat, but actually it's a lovely curry powder and it adds a lot of flavour to it.
For chicken or whatever else you
anything
can put it into.
Can, yeah.
And just go get that. Like you can get this and the Shaoxing wine in, say, like the Asia supermarket.
Yes.
Okay, wow. Right. And well, there's an awful lot of this.
It lasts you a long time.
Perfect.
So I've just added in the bit of that, about a teaspoon of that into the vegetables. So you just stir fry that. And then you add in this lovely Jimmy satay sauce. So I'm going to show you this Jimmy satay sauce because it's absolutely smelling. So it's a mixture of peanuts, chili, Asian kind of spices and herbs. This is the key to this making this dish. And you can use it for marinades. You won't, you know, you'd use it for a lot of different kind of dishes.
Jimmy's satay sauce. Wow. Okay, cool.
So once I stir fry this, you kind of will smell the lovely flavour.
And this has got the peanuts in. You don't need peanut butter.
Well, to make it more creamy and peanutty, I'm going to add in some peanut butter.
Oh, okay.
A tablespoon of peanut butter.
Both, right, okay.
Yeah. But that will give you a lovely creamy texture.
Now, if you didn't... Okay, I suppose you're going for the authentic one now, but if you didn't have Jimmy's satay sauce, can you just use an extra lump or two of peanut butter?
I think...
No.
I just think...
Stay authentic, okay.
Well, I think it just adds this kind of saltiness and sweetness to it. And so it is kind of really nice to have in with it.
Okay.
And then into that, I'm just going to add in some water. So you do let it cook out a bit more.
Mm-hmm.
And then add in some water. So, yeah. Should really heat
up. Is the heat going? Is the cooker...
I'm not really sure.
Get over there now and see.
See, I think...
So I changed it on this one. Anyway, we're all good. So the bit of water then to just kind of create the sauce.
Yes. And then you just all kind of simmer it all down. And then you can add in the rest of your little veggies, like the bamboo shoot, because they don't take as long to cook.
Yeah.
So, and then I'm going to add in a peculiar one, which is some pineapple.
Now that's going to divide people because people like with pizza and pineapple on pizza.
That's the thing, but
you have to try it with the pineapple because it just adds so much kind of flavour to it. And it's something surprising that you kind of go, OK, all these are veggie. And then you go, oh, this
but
nice
then I suppose
kind of juicy
in one
pineapple.
Way, it'll bulk it out as well if you're doing this for a big family meal. Like, it'll bulk it out so it's
kind of
a big
more
dish. Yeah.
So you're doing this very authentic. Like, you're trying to copy, say, so would you find that takeaways and stuff would have pineapple in it?
Yes.
Right, okay.
Actually, well, these are one of my kind of favourite kind of takeaway dishes. So then, and I ordered one and I was like, oh, there's like pineapple in this. And I was like,
Then the chicken goes in last, is it? Because that takes the least time, but because it's been marinating.
Yeah, so the thing is, you could do it two ways. You could actually fry off the chicken first, or you can kind of make the sauce and then add in the chicken. I find it adding in the raw chicken into the sauce is actually makes the chicken a bit more tender.
Yeah,
it's like making an Indian
curry.
It sort
of boils it more, doesn't
it? Yeah, so I actually do it this way, but a lot of people would fry it off. You can, you know, so then you just add in the chicken.
Okay.
And then let it kind of simmer.
And then how long would that just cook away for? 10 minutes? Be all finally done in 10 minutes?
Yeah, it would definitely be.
Because you have one there.
Come on,
that's
try some. Yeah,
are you gonna try some?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah,
that's
please.
It there. Like, so we're saying about after 10 minutes it would be like
it'll be
this.
Lovely kind of
can
a
can we give
down.
Alan lots of the pineapple, please?
And Tommy and Tommy lots of the chicken.
I love lots of chicken, yeah.
Have we got
look at that, gorgeous. There's a fork over there.
So then it just
oh,
cooks
Eva,
down.
Thank you. Oh, that's loads. That's loads.
So it's, okay.
Thank
there
you.
We go.
I have another
look
one.
That.
Here.
Give that down to Tommy. You can start on that.
Wow. Thank you.
So it just makes it kind of.
Right,
nice
I'm going to go for the
creamy.
Pineapple here. Give it a go. It's.
Have to try some.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
It's like sweetness to the peanutty kind of
but
satay
kind of
sauce.
It adds a juiciness to it as well. It's just.
It's
it
really good.
Makes
it's
it
really.
Kind of...
It's hot, but it's delicious. Eva Pau, thank you so much. Looking forward to forcing this into me. Oh. Gorgeous.
Eva, thank you much. Now, up next, Derek is getting a lesson all about the Vikings. See you in a minute. Well, sorry.
Welcome back. Now, it's a go-to for school tours and tourists. And this morning, Derek is in the heart of the capital at Dublinia, dressed up, I assume. There he is, in a tunic. How are you, Derek?
Yes, yeah. We've had another costume change. We're heading back in time here this morning to the period of the Vikings here in Dublinia Christchurch in Dublin city centre. Francis McCarney is with us. Francis, that's a good Irish name, isn't it?
It certainly is a good Irish name, from County Monaghan.
Monaghan, what part of Monaghan?
Right on the border with County Fermanagh.
So you're up by Tommy's neck of the woods. Anyway, let's talk about the Vikings. When did they land in?
So the Vikings came originally raiding Ireland, starting in the year 795. They were coming here raiding monasteries, taking gold, jewels, silver, whatever they could get, maybe a few slaves back to Norway, which is more where most of the Vikings that came to Ireland
came
from.
Yeah, so they weren't here for fun, they were clearing everything out, basically.
They were, but over time, that got a bit more difficult to do, and so in the year 841, they decided to do something a little bit different. They decided to stay here and establish a trading port, which is what they've done exactly here, right where we are here in Dublin.
And Olaf the White, he was the first Viking here, first
he
Viking
was the,
chief.
He was the first Viking king here in Dublin. So that was about 12 years after they'd originally established the port, to 853, he became the first Viking king of Dublin.
Dublin, the name itself, Dublin, derives from that Gaelic word.
So Dublin, Dublin derives from Dublin, two Gaelic words, Blackpool. I'm sure all the school children will know that. Which the Vikings couldn't actually pronounce that properly. They actually said Dufflin, but over time the words Dublin morphed into Dublin.
And where does that derive from then? The meaning of Dublin.
So it derives from the meeting of the Liffey and the Poddle, the waters of these two rivers, which is where they established the camp. The Poddle is a smaller river underground now, but at the time it wasn't, and where the two waters met was big in an area where the Vikings could moor their ships. That's exactly what they were looking to do.
Now, Francis, the Vikings were master craftsmen. They brought a lot of craft and trade here.
They certainly did. They were extremely good boat builders, but also things like jewellery, weaponry, stuff like that, utensils, all this kind of stuff. They're very good craftsmen building all this. Excellent craftsmen.
We're standing here on a very historic site. Very thick walls here in Christchurch as well. Woodquay just down the road as well.
Woodquay just across the road from us here, which is the civic offices of Dublin City Council, and I'm sure some of our older viewers might remember the controversy in the mid-1970s when they were being built. The excavations unearthed the remains of Viking Dublin, including over 200 Viking houses. Very controversial. People said the excavations should be called off. The offices should be put somewhere else. But between the jigs and the reels, Dublin City Council got their way and the offices were built.
And a lot of artefacts that were found now stored.
A lot of the artefacts were saved and most in the National Museum now, but the site itself...
All right, we'll leave you there. Get cooking on the fire because we're going to walkie-talkie here into the next room. And Heather Kelly is with us. And Heather, let's talk about the role that women had in the traditional Viking setup.
Yeah, of course. So women actually had a lot of respect and a lot of... they were very highly thought of. So women could actually choose who they married. They could divorce whenever they wanted.
Really?
Yeah, I know. It's amazing. Quite advanced for the time. The reason was marriage was an alliance. So if the alliance didn't work out, they didn't have to stay together.
Good luck. I'm out of here.
I know. Yeah, exactly. And they also had things like compensation. So you got injured in work, you got paid for it. Now, women were also highly... skilled with their crafts. The main craft that they would do is weaving. So they would make everything from the clothes, from the sails of ships, which would actually take 150 to 180 sheep and 4 years to make.
Some of the artifacts you have here.
Yeah, so we have some nice knoll binding or Viking knitting, basically. And then we also have some beautiful weaving, which is from my loom here. Now, this is actually based on a real Dublin Viking find. It's our very own Viking belt, which is the Dublin Double Dragon. And it was originally found on Fishamble Street, just around the corner from us.
That's incredible. Yeah. That's a replica of it. Up and running 30 years, there's an exhibition on here linking the Viking women that link between Ireland and Norway.
Yeah, so our lovely new Stavanger exhibition all the way from Norway links all of the mobility that we had between Ireland and Norway and also showing the roles of women. So they could be leaders, they could be warriors, they could be weavers, and they were highly respected and things like that.
Okay, well, dublinia.ie is where you'll find them online. By the way, we go out like this at the weekend, right?
Obviously.
Obviously, that's how we rock and roll. Back to you in the studio. Okay, let's get weaving.
Thank you very much, Derek. Look at that.
Thank you, Derek. He really goes hell for leather on those. My school tour went to a shopping centre, so that's actually quite nice. Now, still to come...
You went to a shopping centre on your school tour.
Listen, that happens.
No, hold on. You went to a shopping centre in your school tour?
Yeah.
In Limerick?
No, I went to a different county to go to a different shopping centre. Anyway.
Not just any shopping
coming centre. Coming on in the next hour, are you an Outlander fan? Hello. Well, Jamie from that show stars in a new film with Priyanka Chopra Jonas. We'll be talking to them after nine.
And in fashion, we're looking at styles in shopping centres around the country.
Shopping centres are very different when you cross county lines.
And we are also looking forward to this with Peter Crouch and Abby Clancey are going to join us for a chat about their new relationships podcast. We have lots coming up in the next hour of Ireland M. Don't go away.
From Ballymount to Bollywood. We've got lots in store this hour.
We sure have a fun hour coming your way. They have been winning rave reviews for their new podcast at 20 past nine. We're going to be chatting to Peter Crouch and Abby Clancey about the therapy Crouch.
Thoroughly enjoy it.
It's very funny. They're very entertaining.
They're
the two
so
of them.
Good. She's also the former Bollywood star who made the move to Hollywood. Priyanka Chopra Jonas will be joining us later this hour to talk about landing her first big rom-com.
To that. Now, with the sun still playing a bit of hide-and-seek out there, there are many hoping to get away to sunnier climates very shortly. Alan, you're going to get us sorted.
Yes, hopefully, Tommy. Hopefully the sun will come out today. We'll talk to Derek about that in a few minutes. But stylist Justine King now joins us because we all are looking forward to our sun holidays and getting away, and that's exactly what you're doing in fashion this morning.
Absolutely. So it's all about the kind of bright colours, light textures, holiday footwear. I'm so excited to see the toes. You know, we've got sliders, we've got wedges. So yeah, whether you're planning a sun holiday or, fingers crossed, Ireland gives us a nice summer, but this is all thinking ahead to the sunnier
climate. Is it just
me
or is it coming in later because the spring has been quite cold and miserable?
I know, we're absolutely deserving to be wearing our beautiful like dresses this. And our jumpsuits and everything, so that's coming up a little later.
Okay, looking forward to that, and as I said, hopefully the sun will come out today. Derek, what's the weather like?
gone.
Al, look, no sun, no fun. I'm getting punished here in the stocks because of the lack of the sunshine out there at the moment. Heavy thundery rain right across your window, unfortunately, folks. So I think you're bang on the money with the getaway fashion. And I think she feels the same as well. What do you think? Yeah, she's with me. Back to you, studio.
For a second.
Oh, I love it.
For a second.
Cheer up.
For a second, I was like, is that a real person? I like
love
her.
Love it.
That's how we are first thing in the morning. Thank you, Derek. Talk to him in just a little while.
We compare 14 insurance quotes to get you the best deal. So choose chill and work smarter, not harder.
Yes, sure. We've moved into the marketplace here in our Viking Tour Dublinian Christchurch in Dublin City Centre this morning. We're keeping busy. Anyway, we're getting past 9 o'clock here together. Let's take a look at how it's shaping up weather-wise. And still plenty of rain hitting parts of South Mayo into Galway, right across Clare, right through the northwest. In fact, now past 9 o'clock, some heavy rain there up around parts of Sligo, South Donegal, into Leitrim and North County Roscommon, parts of Fermanagh not escaping either. So do stay nice and dry in those light to moderate westerly breezes now right across today. In fact, we're going to see some bright spells, quite limited in nature, as we work our way through your Wednesday. Once again, day three of some thunderstorm activity of it, and a good rattle through the northeast later on today, with top temps slightly cooler as well at 11 to 15. And across into this evening, more thundery showers crisscrossing the eastern northeastern part of the island. Elsewhere into late evening by night, we're going to see a system of rain feed in from the northwest, so another bumpy ride tucking our way into Thursday, with that westerly airflow taking us right across the next 12 to 24 hours. So that's how it's shaping up for now. Come back to us live in around 9:35.
Chill insurance work harder so you can work smarter. We compare 14 quotes to get you the best deal.
Hello.
You're very welcome back. Now, earlier on, we were talking about grocery inflation. We had Neale Richmond in from the government. Mm-hmm. Obviously, they're taking the supermarkets to task later on today. This is an interesting one from Tara, sent a message in to say, shoppers are forced to purchase substandard, cheaper options in the such as basics like bread, butter, ham, and luxury items are now coffee and antiperspirant. And I definitely see that for children, that now you're encouraged. It's so much cheaper to buy a packet of crisps are like sweets,
yeah,
as opposed to buying healthy snacks for children.
For what
I
you
find,
can do.
Yeah, like the healthy stuff.
Now, I'm
is
sure the brand zone would sort of wouldn't say they're substandard, but I know what you mean. Like,
well,
supermarket
cheaper or ingredients go into a lot of those things.
Come on. Yeah. And if you're looking, there's an awful lot of tips on TikTok in relation to deodorant at the minute. So you put this acid, you buy it for really, like, it's a cheap thing, and you put it underneath, and then you don't need your deodorant because it tackles the bacteria.
You put deodorant acid on your armpits?
No, it's like an acid that we use for our faces. Like, it's a cheap...
What is the acid?
Is it salicylic or one of them?
But it surely is that.
Should know
I think
that.
You should probably know before you
I'll put up. I'll put it
on
up on my
armpit.
I'll put it up on my
more
Instagram
expensive?
No, because you get loads of it. You put it on and it's grand. Whereas deodorant only tackles the smell.
Imagine the
not
white.
The bacteria.
Imagine the patches on the armpits, so you're
but do you know it's actually burn a hole in the T-shirt?
I think it's...
And then you've got antiperspirant sorted.
But you know it's good as well? Cheap vodka.
Cheap vodka.
What, rub it on your armpits? Come on. Alan, you were knocking back the cheap vodka last night, obviously watching the Eurovision. Can we ask Alan, the Eurovision oracle, what he thinks it will take for Ireland to win the Eurovision? It's becoming a bit embarrassing.
Yeah, I think we have to go to a national song contest, get rid of that Late Late Show special and do it properly the way the rest of Europe do.
Okay, so
we have to start from the basic. We have to make it encourage.
What's the difference with it being on the Late Late?
It looks terrible and it sounds terrible on the Late Late because that's the image that Europe sees first. Look, I'm just sort of saying I didn't think they turned up last night. I think they did great, but they played to the audience in the Bank Arena and they didn't play to the people who were at home. And I think that's where.
Do you think Wild Youth
contest.
Were the right band
I think, no, I
to
thought,
represent
I,
Ireland?
Wild Youth with a different song could have done really well. I thought that anthemic We Are One type of thing just doesn't wash anymore. So, I just think, because Wild Youth have had great songs over the years.
Yeah, when they have.
And so I think they should have just gone down and stuck with their own way of doing stuff, and I think we would have had a better result. Look at, but like, people, Sweden have Melody Festival up there, which is huge. You go through different heats every week just to get into the final.
So basically, Patrick Kilty, you don't even have the job yet, but you're not getting the Eurovision next year, is what
I don't think
saying.
It should be on the Late Late Special. I don't think we can do it well on the Late
Late
Special.
Just to let you know, glycolic acid is the acid I'm talking about for the armpits. It's an antibacterial. Put it on. That's what it is.
So how much is a glycolic acid then?
Yeah, exactly. It costs you more than deodorant would.
What?
How much is glycolic acid?
I can't Google everything while you're rabbiting on about the
But you're telling people it's going to be cheaper.
Thank you so
much.
I bought it. For your text
I think it was about €6 and it's a big tub of it. Oh, my God.
Oh, dear.
Do you know what? I think we might have a couple coming up next who fight more than us three. I'm not too sure. Maybe they do. They've got... Oh, look, they do. They do. Hopefully, we can get them to fight more than we do. It is the wonderful Abby Clancey and Peter
I don't
Crouch
think Abby uses glycolic acid under her arms now, to be honest.
Oh, my God.
I am. I'm trying.
Oh, she does.
In your face. Thank you, Abby.
See you later.
Girls,
see you after
together.
The break.
We'll talk to you in a minute.
You're very welcome back. Now, our next guests are familiar faces from the worlds of football and modelling, respectively.
Yeah, already joined in matrimony. They've recently paired up to provide relationship advice on their brand new podcast, The Therapy Crouch. But before we chat to Peter Crouch and Abby Clancey, look at them, they're all lovely. Let's take a clip from the podcast, The Therapy Crouch.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to the... By me, Abby Clancey.
And me, Peter Crouch.
And welcome to the... Oh, my God! Unfiltered sexy fun. Come on, because I'm hungry.
We've got some experience in this field. I'd like to think we can
Why can't you just say? We're married. We've got 4 kids, 2 cats, 1 dog, to set up who we are first. What? And then we can give advice. What? Hi, everyone, and welcome to The Therapy Crouch. The Therapy Crouch is a brand new podcast by me, Abby Clancey.
And me, Peter Crouch. We've been together for 15 years. We've got 4 kids. We've got a dog. We've got 2 cats. So I feel like we've got some experience to share with you, plenty of stories and hopefully a little bit of advice as well.
No stone's going to be left unturned. It's light-hearted, fun. You know, our trip's fucking hell.
Sorry for that. We forgot to beep that here as well.
Morning television. Apologies for any children watching this morning, but yeah.
They're at school.
Good morning.
How are you doing? That is, Abby, are we going to have some unfiltered sexy fun this morning?
Always, honey. Always.
I mean, you pretty much set up what The Therapy Crouch is about, but where did the idea come from? And why did you think that being together for 15 years... actually come together, working together on a podcast was a good idea?
Well, to be honest, we thought about it in lockdown. We're always together. And Pete's got his own successful podcast. And we thought, you know, it'd be fun to do one together. And because we're so busy, it's not often that we actually sit down together and talk about our relationship and the experiences we've had in our life. So, you know, it's actually been so enjoyable, hasn't it, for us?
It has, yeah. It is a bit of therapy, to be honest, because we're like, you know, you say we're so busy and I'm out working and then it's the kids and then you don't really have time to sit down and discuss things as a couple. Or basically, you know, Abby just hammers me and I listen for an hour.
Like most relationships, to be honest, isn't it?
But you really do go, like, I'm enjoying it so much because, my God, are you letting us into your lives? Like... Peter, you told a story about being out drinking until 7 a.m. the day of your wedding. Happily chatting about that. Happy time in your life?
Yeah, do you know what? Like, I think because Abby's brother and cousin record it, like,
Our guards down?
Yeah, our guards down completely. And, like, we obviously say probably
too much.
Far too much. And then we have to rein it back in slightly. So, you know, there are certain things where we're just like, no, I don't do that. That's too far. But most of it, you know, I think, you know, if you are unguarded, it's the same with the football podcast I do. I think, you know, the more you sort of let people in, the more enjoyable it is and the more real it is, really.
Yeah, I think that was important for us. You know, there's no point in doing a podcast that's completely edited and is not the real us. You know, we're just like everyone else. We have highs and lows, ups and downs, laughs, whatever. And we just wanted to be as natural as possible.
Absolutely, absolutely. And that's why it's got such engagement, all the podcasts you're involved in as well. But is that actually true, though, Peter? Because whenever Muireann mentioned it, your head went down and Abby's went, yeah. So you went out on the beers the night before the wedding and...
Didn't stop.
How did you get through the wedding day?
It was a lot. You know when people just keep arriving and you haven't seen them for ages? It was basically like a wedding for me and my mates, basically. And then obviously we just got carried away. And then I saw Abby up in the window and I thought, oh no, she's seen me. So I ran back to the room at 6 a.m. I pulled the covers up and obviously she's barged in and ripped the covers off me. I'm like, oh, as if I was asleep. She's ripped the covers off me. I'm full suit, shoes, and a bottle of beer in my hand like that. And I was bang to rights, really. But yeah, I mean, listen, you know.
Didn't get hangovers either. Like, if that was me, I'd be dead. Like, I went to bed at like 11 on the night before the wedding, but you know, Pete was just having too much of a good time. I think he thought it was his last night of freedom, maybe.
I just love sitting there with the beer going, babes, I've totally been in. Yeah. There was, Abby, obviously you've got an awful lot of Irish family with a name like Clancey, and your Irish family had a way, they were like wondering if there was any Irish in Peter, and apparently the eyes gave it away, was it?
Dead like a fish. She's fully English, this one.
Is that what they said? He's not. There's no Irish in him.
Yeah, it was
no Irish in him. It was Fabian. It was my dad's uncle.
Yeah, and he basically said to me, "Have you got any Irish in you?" And I said, "No, I don't think so. No, I don't think there's any." And he said, "Of course, so. Yeah, eyes are dead like a fish."
But my sister's actually, I was just about to say engaged to. She isn't engaged to at all. Her boyfriend's from Dublin. So we spend a lot of time there. I know Catherine's mum's watching now, so hi, Catherine. But we love Dublin. We recently did a trip there and we went to the Guinness factory and all we went to Cassidy's and just had the best time. Like, it's one of our favourite places to go to.
Absolutely. We saw it all over social media as well. You didn't go knock on Bono's door as well, because I gather that was the one way you thought, Peter, you might have got back into the good books, is that if you got Bono to perform. It didn't quite happen.
No. I mean, Ab, for some reason, has got this thing. Like, obviously, we like you two, right? And our wedding song was Sometimes You Can't Make It On Your Own. And she said, why can't you just get, Bono to sing it for me? And I was like, well, like, I'm sure he's a busy man, you know? And I'm like, I can't just bring up Bono. But funny enough, when we were in Dublin, she was like, right, let's go and find Bono. She was like, right, okay, where does he live? As if we're, like, stalking him. And then one of our friends sent a picture, and he was in London. So we left London to go to Dublin, and... Our friends are sitting next to him in a restaurant in London.
I just love Bono. He's literally my favourite person.
Well, Bono, if you're watching, will
big
you let them
the
let
show.
Them come out to Dalkey, and then you'll run into them, and they'll come back over. It'll be
Cassidy's
a great.
Was the wrong pub.
I know they should have been out in Dalkey. That was it. I suppose you've got all this going on. Tommy has mentioned that Peter Crouch podcast, which is hugely successful as well. But now that's a spin-off into that Peter Crouch film. You're going to be a film star, Peter?
Oh my God! Yeah. I forgot this was coming out today, to be honest. But I mean, when they asked me, I was like, you know, surely, you know, even in the start of it, it was like, you know, I think, you know, it's Alex Ferguson, Usain Bolt, you know, Pete Sampras. So I was thinking, you know, what do you want to do a film about me for? But you know what? It's been amazing going through everything, and you know, obviously going back through the football stuff, and it was all good fun, and I've loved making it, and hopefully people enjoy watching it.
And what's the idea?
I've seen a few tasters of it, and you know, because I don't give Pete a chance to talk to me about football that often because I'm not a football fan. But like seeing all the old videos of him as a kid and, you know, how he got to where he is, it's actually a really incredible story.
And how long those legs were, even back when you were a kid as well, Peter.
Oh, my God, honestly. You know, I look back and obviously it starts with a few dark times and things like that. And, you know, because, listen, I look different, you know, and I don't look like your average footballer. And that obviously is the start of it. And, you know, how people judge me because of the way I looked and things like that. It's quite a journey, if you like. And if you look at sort of Michael Owen's journey or Steven Gerrard's journey, it's just like, they were good and then they were incredible. You know, mine just had peaks and troughs. I was up and down, and it was a tale of sort of, you know, coming back and you know, doing well and then struggling again. And that kind of thing. So it was, yeah, it's a bit of an up and down tale, but something I'm really proud of and glad to have been involved.
Absolutely. Oh, yeah, like, well, like you have, but like it would be a true inspiration to a lot of young people who kind of think that, you know, they're not maybe the right shape, the right size, things don't go well for them, and then you can still make it to the top. So fair play to you. I'm looking forward to seeing that. And to you, Abby, as well, even for Britain's Next Top Model. You know,
but hold on, aren't you writing a book, a parenting and relationship book, Abby?
Yeah, we've been asked a lot, like, to bring a book out about, you know, the therapy crouch, and, you know, we're just having so much fun. We just feel so lucky to be in a position where people are enjoying listening to us argue and bicker and have a laugh, and they want more. So,
I think we should say that, like, it's been billed as a sort of therapy handbook. Please don't use any of this therapy. Probably. I'm sure there's certainly some people more, you know, highly qualified than us. Although we are very good, we are not professionals.
The disclaimer, that's on everything.
But listen, as you said, three kids, two cats, four kids, two cats, one dog. I mean, still together 12 years married. Like, listen, that's what people want to hear, because everything is an up and a down in a relationship, isn't it?
No, it is. You know, I think everyone has times of, you know, problems or up and down, but, you know, I think, you know, we love each other.
Yeah, yeah, and it helps that I'm gorgeous.
Listen, it's honestly been a real pleasure. I'm really enjoying the podcast. I know you've got like two competing podcasts now with Peter's and with your own one together, but it's thoroughly enjoyable. It's called The Therapy Crouch, Abby Clancey and Peter Crouch. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thanks for having us,
absolute
guys.
Absolute pleasure. Thank
Cheers.
You,
Thank you so much. Look at that. No dead fish eyes here. Look at them. Oh, sparkly right. Irish eyes.
I struggle to have your eyes open at this time of the morning.
Hello, in fashion, it's Looks for the Sun.
Are we looking for sun? We're desperately looking for some sun today. And stylist Justine King is here to get us in the holiday mood, because I think we're all going to be just booking a holiday.
I think you can
get out somewhere to get a bit of sun.
Yes. And it's just nice to see the colours and the prints and remind us that it is summer, or almost summer anyway.
Absolutely. We'll get Sarah Morrissey is out with our first look today.
So we've got our pop of colour in the red here from Sarah Morrissey. And I think it's really important, first of all, when you're thinking of holiday style, baggage is limited, so dresses like this that you could wear at night or during the day with a pair of flats are really crucial. So this one is from My Kind of Dress online Irish store, and it's that kind of linen texture, which of course is probably the best texture for the hotter climates. It's a beautiful dress. It has that kind of wrap little front there and the side tie, as you can see there, and then the elasticated waist on it too. So a nice roomy one as well when you're on your holidays, and then it has that little beautiful frill detail and the buttons down the front. So the attention to detail in this dress is really gorgeous.
And that's a false tie, is it?
That is, well, yeah, ties. It's not a full wrap.
Yeah,
the bottom part is just the wrap skirt on that one, yeah. Send the popping red as well. It's just really kind of vibrant, I think, on holidays, especially with a little bit of a sun-kissed tan too.
Very nice. Well, oh, Sarah's putting up, I can see the sun, moon and stars on her wrist there. We'll go to jewellery.
Okay, perfect. So her jewellery here, we'll start with that bracelet. So it's a gorgeous charm bracelet, and that one is from Linnet Jewellery. So Linnet are an Irish brand that are online, but they're also in Arnott's now. They have a gorgeous concession there. And as you can see, the sun, moon and the stars, and the little bit of a diamante as well. So that's a nice holiday bracelet. It does have a matching necklace if you wanted to wear those together too.
And you put a little simple earring there.
Yeah, so those earrings have multicolour stones going through them. So you could pick out really any of the beautiful little stones or just wear them with plain colour too. But they've got kind of blues and pinks and greens and everything going through those, and they just sparkle beautifully.
And you were saying earlier on, it's great to get the elf feet out.
Yeah,
the sandals,
get the pedicures
get the toes
done.
Out.
So these are from Murphy Shoes. Beautiful champagne espadrilles. So these are great if you're just bringing one pair of heels away. They're going to go with literally any kind of dresses or jumpsuits in your wardrobe. If you do want the little bit of height, and then of course that espadrille just screams of summer, and they have a nice cushioned sole as well. So
if you were going away for a week, how many pairs of shoes would you bring?
Not too many. I actually am pretty good. One pair of heels.
One pair of heels. Cool.
And then a
good.
Couple of flats. kind of tend to be a flat.
I'm kind of done with the heels now.
Yeah. So we're into the flats now with our second look. So we'll start off with her outfit here. And this is a great kind of airport style, I think, as well, that you could then wear without the denim jacket when you get on holidays. So this is from Friday's Edit, another online Irish store. So it's a mid-wash denim jacket, classic fit. It has a nice stretch in it, and then a little bit of distressed denim in that too. And as you know, throw it on over absolutely anything. One denim jacket probably does you if it's a little bit cooler as well on holidays in the evenings.
Ooh, peekaboo.
Yeah, nice little jumpsuit here, nice alternative to the dress, and it's nice and light as well. So I think this one as a beach cover-up, you can put that over
your bed. You're going for lunch after you have your... Just after being on the sun, lounger for a couple of hours.
100%. And then you could wear your wedges if you wanted to dress it up in a pair of glam earrings, but we're kind of going for that daytime travel style look. As you saw, the little cutout in the back means you can wear your own bra with it too, because it has that bit covering the bra too.
Beautiful. And the flats?
Yeah, so the flats then, these again, a nice cushion sole. Sarah was only saying how comfortable they are. What I love about them is that buckle is adjustable. So for a wider foot as well, it can kind of adjust for different foot sizes, which is great. And then they're just kind of dressy enough that you could wear them in the evening as well on your holidays too.
Gorgeous. You've gone out with the jewellery here. Loads of rings, loads of earrings.
Yeah, so we'll start with those gorgeous earrings. So first of all, there's a little ear cuff, as you can see, but that doesn't require a piercing. So that can just be hooked anywhere on your ear, and it has the little diamante detailing too. And then the modern curve kind of half hoop earrings. We've seen those a lot kind of now as an everyday earring, but you could layer them up with multiple ear cuffs and stuff too.
Gorgeous. And the rings.
Yeah, so I've stacked loads of rings here from Linnet Jewellery. I think with rings, kind of have loads of fun with them. If you pick kind of one metallic to bring away with you like this, like your gold, you could wear as many or as few as you want. Yeah. Bring your little bag of jewellery, as you can see, the star detail. But these rings are all adjustable, so they mean you don't have to have a ring size, which I think when you're shopping online for jewellery, you might know your ring size, it means you can just adjust them.
Sarah, hide that engagement ring, because we know that's a bit more expensive there. She's putting it down, she's like, that's not it. We've got Danny with our third look today.
Yeah, another beautiful colour pop here, and this one is from Nicola Ross. So they have two boutiques in Nice, and they're also online, nice Irish family-owned business. This dress is gorgeous because it suits so many different body types. It comes in a small up to a double XL. I love that faux wrap front for the bigger bust. And then the gorgeous pleated skirt too. And it has a little mini slip underneath the skirt as well.
Gorgeous.
Comes in a range of colours. So they have this in the same geometric print in pink, in red, in green with a little bit of navy. So there's kind of something for everyone in that dress. And it's kind of easy to wear, isn't it?
Very much. Loads of sizes. Then we're going to see their smaller wedge.
Yes, so these are a nice kind of modest wedge. Again, they're going to go with everything. So I think if you're just bringing one wedge, these or the champagne ones. These have a little bit of rose gold, as you can see there, and then the cream too. So those with, you know, cream cutoffs like you're wearing today, they'd be gorgeous in Ireland in the summer too, and not just for dress. They're going to go really with everything.
And the jewellery?
Yeah, so starting off with her necklace there, that is a personalised piece. So Linnet Jewellery do these build-your-own necklaces where you can pick up to 6 initials included in the price, and then you can add your own kind of charms with those too as you go. So,
lovely.
There's Jenny's name on it.
Yes, that one has.
Okay, and the lovely bracelets there.
Yeah, so I've stacked loads of bangles here. So we have the Showstopper, which is a crisscross bangle. As you can see, it's got the 18 karat gold plated with Roman numeral detailing, then that T-bar link bracelet, and then just the gold dream bangle. So we've just stacked loads.
Gorgeous. Danny, thank you so much. They are lovely, and we're going to have a quick as a jiffy look at Sarah Marzi in our final look today.
Yes, so we're going for the pink. I mean, it really is the colour of this year, and this dress kind of does the talking for you. It's from Nicola Ross again. It's got the leopard print going through it. This is a great kind of like daytime or evening dress. I'd love this with flats on holidays too. Nice and light, and it requires very little accessories with this dress because there is kind of so much already going on it. Really flattering, but the drawstring waist means it can kind of be pulled in as loose or as tight on holidays, which I think is always crucial.
I quite like these shoes.
They're nice, aren't they?
Yeah, kind of a modest heel, but an unusual heel on those shoes too. And then that beautiful front on them is really flattering on the foot. They're pink, they are genuine suede as well, so they're going to wear really well.
They are kind of pretty, aren't they?
They're very cool.
Yeah,
I really like them,
actually.
You don't want to go too high on our heels.
And then, as you said, minimum jewellery.
Yes, so her earrings here, they are beautiful, actually heart-shaped hoops that she's wearing. They're the Tiamo earrings. So we're keeping this look super kind of girly, and they are the gold plating as well. And again, I've just stacked up lots of rings with this look too. So picking up on that pink that's going through the dress in the diamante detailing. And then we have the anti-anxiety spinning ring, which they specialise in.
The anti-anxiety?
Anti-anxiety. So you can spin this ring if you're kind of someone who likes to fiddle.
Look at her go, Sarah. Beautiful spinning there.
So they do these in silver and in the gold plating.
What do you mean? Like, so
I do that a lot. Yeah, people would often spin their rings.
This one, actually, the outer layer kind of can be spun. So there's someone who fiddles with your rings.
Like a fidget spinner on your rings. I like it. Justine King, thank you so much. Fabulous. Coming up next, Priyanka Chopra Jonas talks to us about Celine Dion and her husband, Nick Jonas. Talk to you shortly. Hello, welcome back to Ireland Day. I'm out in cinemas today. Love Again is a new romantic comedy starring Priyanka Chopra Jones and Outlander's Sam Heughan. The film sees Sam's character, his love life, getting a helping hand from none other than Celine Dion. Before we chat to both of them, here's a clip from Love Again.
I'm just wearing my dead boyfriend's shirt and texting his old number. I begin every day thinking of you.
Ever since I changed my number, someone's been sending me these texts.
It sounds like a psychotic stalker.
I think they're nice.
You need to pursue this.
It's been 2 years. There's nothing wrong with putting yourself back out there again.
Why is every guy shirtless?
That is a little bit from the new movie Love Again, and it's great to welcome its stars to Ireland AM, Priyanka Chopra Jonas and Sam Heughan. Thank you both for joining us this morning, guys. So, Priyanka, first of all, you are, of course, no stranger to romance with all of the Bollywood films that you've done. But now your name is over the door of a massive Hollywood rom-com. How do you feel?
It's very, very exciting. And it's more exciting to me because, like you said, I've done romantic comedies and the genre in my Bollywood movies so much, but I didn't get to explore that in Hollywood. So it's really fun. Like, while I have Citadel on Prime, where I'm this kick-ass character, I have Mira in theaters, which is another aspect of a, you know, strong woman. Dealing with grief, grappling with the realities of life. So it's just very, very exciting to be able to have that. And I was very hungry for a part like this. So, and this movie is so cute and has the best cast and just like is wholesome, you know?
You've got all bases covered, haven't you?
Wholesome.
All bases covered.
But sure, we've been crying out for more rom-coms for ages.
Right?
We need it.
It's time for to feel good, right? It's time for everyone to feel some love.
So, Sam, you're taking a break from the constant running for your life in your TV show, Outlander. So something very different is going on with you in Love Again. You get to learn Celine Dion songs. That's got to be fun, right?
Yeah. It's a nice welcome break from Outlander. Obviously, I love that show, and there's a lot of romance in that. But this is a different, you know, it's a different different genre. And it was such a nice family. We created this bubble during COVID that we were shooting in. And of course, you know, Celine Dion and her music really makes this movie just something really special.
Yeah, like there she is, Miss Dion. It's amazing. Also, in this film, is your real-life husband Priyanka. So did you have to teach, here's the question, Nick Jonas, your husband, how to kiss badly for that beautifully cringy scene in the taxi?
Yeah, how much practice did you do for that?
Oh, we are very method about, you know, our jobs. Put in a lot of practice. it was really funny. I didn't have to. I would never. Nick is supremely talented and helped us out when we were in a pickle with the movie because, you know, we had to cast an actor for the job. But because we were in COVID, this actor would have had to come and stay for like 2 weeks and quarantine and then would come and do the scene or whatever. And so, you know, it was really awesome that Nick jumped in, and it was such a fun part of the movie and so unexpected and such a fun surprise that I think people really respond to it well.
What a terrible day at the office having to work with your actual husband. And Sam, of course, you were sitting there looking at Priyanka as her character going, fall in love with me, look over here.
No, I'm trying to be like, he's my date from hell. So
right,
it's like it was a test of my acting abilities
for sure. For you guys not to have chemistry, but he's so good in the movie, isn't he? He's brilliant. He's very funny and
so cute.
It's great. It's a great little surprise for viewers.
Now, Sam, with your character, the way he through modern technology kind of stalks Mira's thoughts. Be honest now, what would you make of this fella in real life if he was your mate?
Stalking, is it too much? I mean, look, you know, I think he falls in love with her words, right? And I think it's beautiful that it's not all about the way she looks. It's, you know, her thoughts and her feelings. And he's given up on love. He's become very cynical about it. And I think he falls in love again. And through the guidance of Celine Dion, he learns to open himself up to the world and the universe. And I think there's a great message there.
Sure, look, if we could have Celine Dion sorting out our love lives, it would be a beautiful thing. It Priyanka, Sam, thank you both for joining us this morning on Ireland AM.
Thanks so much. Thanks.
Now let's take another clip from Love Again. It is out in cinemas now.
How's it going with the unknown texter?
She's not unknown anymore.
Now you can tell her you've been reading her text to her dead boyfriend.
But she'll never speak to me again.
Things like this don't just happen. Love has a plan for each and every one of us. Hi, this is Celine Dion.
Sure. And I'm Mariah Carey.
Love comes to those who believe it. And this is really me.
Oh my gosh, hi.
And she talks about being in Dublin for the Eurovision.
She won the Eurovision with Ne partez pas sans moi.
Did you know?
That's why he loves Mbappe. He can say,
Coming up on tomorrow's show, we're reviewing all the new film releases, such as the must-see documentary on Michael J. Fox.
Best-selling and critically acclaimed author, Irish author Anne Griffin, is going to be here to discuss her new book, The Island of Longing.
Plus, we'll be looking at some of the best getaways for the upcoming June Bank holiday weekend.
Ireland AM is back tomorrow from 7. Have a great day. We'll see you then. Bye.
See you later.